Welcome back to Pulse Tech News. Another week has come and gone, and therefore we gather now to assess the damage and try to make sense of it all. Like, why would AMD, perhaps the greatest foe and rival of Intel, sign up to have that very same Intel manufacture chips for them? Why is the annual launch season that usually inundates us with new products looking so barren and launchless? And how is it possible that EA has found a way to suck even more? I can't promise to answer all these questions, my friends, but I can promise that together, we can gaze upon them and collectively ask, what the fuck is going on? Well, I'll tell you what the fuck is going on. Fucking tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair Xenon Edge 14.5-inch LCD touchscreen, a 2560 by 720 resolution 60Hz panel designed to attach to your monitor, mount to your PC case, or to be front and center in your setup with the detachable magnetic stand. Connection is easy via HDMI or USB-C with DisplayPort Alt mode support, and the 5-point touchscreen allows you to easily control what's displayed, whether that's system stats via Corsair's IQ software integration, app widgets, a live chat feed while streaming, or just some background music or video playback. Vertical and horizontal orientation are both supported, so for more on the Xenon Edge touchscreen, click the sponsor link in the video description. Our lead story broke Wednesday when Semaphore published an article detailing, with as few details as possible, that Intel is in early talks to add AMD as a foundry customer. Intel has had a tumultuous year so far, to say the least, though recent investments by SoftBank, Nvidia, and the US government have buoyed them along for now. But what they really need is a legit customer for their foundries, and while AMD would absolutely represent that, they are direct rivals across multiple subcategories of tech hardware, both in the consumer and enterprise spaces, so they make strange bedfellows, unlike your mom. Since both AMD and Intel have declined to comment on this, though, there are a few details, as mentioned, with most of the discussion focused around the implication of such a thing if it were to actually happen. Now, to be fair, there has been collaboration betwixt AMD and Intel before, such as with long-term crossover x86 licensing and products like the Kaby Lake G CPU that used a discrete AMD Radeon Vega GPU chip back in 2017. And this would align with former CEO Pat Gelsinger's plans to build fabs with a broad range of customers that might include rivals like AMD. But it's unlikely that Intel will suddenly start manufacturing Zen 5 or Zen 6 CPU chiplets or even RDNA GPUs anytime soon. Those are fabbed by TSMC. But Intel might be able to provide complementary chips such as I/O dies or controllers that aren't typically manufactured on leading edge nodes but are still needed for current gen products. For Intel, this would obviously make sense as they are looking for any major customer to sign on and make use of their very expensive 18A, 14A, or previous generation fabs, but it makes some sense for AMD too. Apart from the sheer brass-balled confidence they would be showing in their market position and product stack versus Intel, they would also be diversifying their fab usage, which is currently very much TSMC-based, and the geopolitical situation surrounding Taiwan can at times be uncertain, shall we say. TSMC also has many other customers besides AMD, including Nvidia and Apple, and Intel, of course, which is kind of funny to me, but not having to compete with all of them for fab time would also be a benefit. The market seems to think this is a good idea too, as AMD and Intel stocks both went up after the story broke. The other big news this week came out Monday, as it appears video game developer and publisher EA will be going private in the biggest leveraged buyout deal in history, worth $55 billion that will be funded by an investment consortium including US-based private equity firm Silver Lake, Affinity Partners, an investment firm started in 2021 by Jared Kushner, and the Saudi Arabia Public Investment Fund, which is their sovereign wealth fund, meant to provide long-term financial stability for Saudi Arabia as they wean themselves off an oil-based economy. Once again, I pause here to remind you all that I really just want to talk about video games and computers, but I'm obliged to talk about Saudi Arabia's public investment fund. Gosh, life sure is weird. Being a leveraged buyout, though, EA will also take on $20 billion in debt. And as some have pointed out, that's a lot of debt. And just the interest alone on $20 billion should be in the ballpark of $1 billion a year, while EA's net income in recent years is barely more than that, so just over a billion annually. It doesn't give much leeway for poor performance, to say nothing of paying down the debt if that's the plan, which paints a dismal outlook for the future of EA and the game development studios it owns, such as BioWare, Criterion, DICE, and Respawn. EA already did not have the best reputation for making gamer-friendly choices in the games it developed, or treating the game developers it acquired well for that matter, so the prospect of new private equity owners with an urgent need to cut costs wherever possible to manage $20 billion of debt does not bode well. Comments from workers at aforementioned subsidiary studios like BioWare are already sounding the alarm that their future is in jeopardy, and shuttering studios, cutting staff, and selling off intellectual property could very well be in the plans, which could mean beloved titles like Mass Effect 5 are scooped up by other devs who will lovingly craft their next iterations. But that's probably overly optimistic speculation, which I dabble in from time to time. It gives me a sense of pride and accomplishment. Speaking of a sense of pride and accomplishment, I also get that from efficiently briefing through Tech Breeze. Or the other way around. Lately, I've had a nagging feeling that I should be doing something, and that's because it's October and that's when launch season usually happens, but where are the launches? No NVIDIA RTX 50 Supers till CES, no AMD CPUs coming, it seems. Radeon rumors have swirled but don't seem to be manifesting. Intel has an Arrow Lake refresh coming, it's said, but I've kind of already written that off. And I guess maybe we'll see Arc B700 GPUs soon? Pretty scant, but we're not wholly without next-gen hardware news. Per Unico's Hardware, MSI said in their Discord that their 800 series motherboards will be future CPU ready. And what better assurance could we ask for? Basically, this confirms Zen 6 on AM5, and in case you're wondering, this came out because MSI is launching a bunch of new 800 series motherboards, including their Max lineup, which, knowing MSI's acronyms, probably stands for Maximum AMD Extreme, and they want you to pronounce it MAX instead of Max. But no Zen 6 CPUs this year. Dialing back the sarcasm a bit though, here's a good news trifecta. Good GPU news, good budget gaming news, and good Intel news, all courtesy of relentless benchmarking performed by good old Steve of Hardware Unboxed. Intel's Arc Battlemage GPUs, particularly the B580, were reviewed well and offer great bang for the buck, but were held back in two ways. First, the B580 was overpriced to $300 plus for quite some time, but thankfully, availability at the $250 MSRP has been consistent as of the past couple months. Second, there was a driver overhead problem, meaning that when paired with lower powered CPUs, particularly 6-core options favored in budget builds, performance dropped off more significantly with the B580 than with comparable AMD and NVIDIA GPUs. When paired with the 9800X3D, for example, the B580 was 13% faster than the RTX 4060 in Spider-Man Remastered, but dropped to 27% slower with a 6-core 5600. Since driver version 7028 released at the end of August, however, that performance drop has vanished, in some titles at least, which is good for budget gamers who can more confidently stick with a 6-core CPU, and hopefully good for Intel's Arc program too, which we hope doesn't get axed, and I'd say that's overall good news for GPU competition and PC gaming as a whole. What's not good for PC gaming is when hardware prices go up, but things are not looking optimistic on that front, at least when it comes to DRAM and storage, which are both somewhat essential to a functional computer. AI is to blame, of course, and what seemed speculative at first is looking more assured as analysts and industry insiders weigh in. OpenAI's Stargate project, announced in January and likely furthered by last week's $100 billion promised investment from NVIDIA, is a massive data center buildout that could soon require as many as 900,000 DRAM wafers per month, per Reuters, which represents about 40% of global manufacturing capacity. This includes DDR5 and HBM memory, and storage is also in demand due to AI needs, so RAM, SSD, and hard drive prices are all ticking upwards. And power bills too, as data centers continue to consume more and more power, increasing demand. But at least we all benefit by seeing more and more soulless AI-generated slop videos on our feeds every day, which is absolutely worth it. If news about AI increasing SSD prices has you stressed, consider buying this SSD. It's the Apacer AS712 Bamboo, an external SSD that combines digital storage with an essential oil diffuser, just like we've all been asking for like forever. Featuring 3D NAND flash, a USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C connection, and read speeds up to 1,000 megabytes per second, the AS712 lets you add essential oils to the bamboo surface or the included diffuser stone that's part of the docking cradle. It's a great way to relax and mask the scent of that blunt you just smoked to try to forget about how AI is increasing SSD and RAM prices. Speaking of blunt force trauma, ASUS. As reported a couple weeks back, after a lengthy GitHub investigation posted by Zefkek seemed to root out the cause of stutters, freezes, and audio crackles regularly experienced by ASUS ROG laptops, ASUS responded that they'll look into it. And it seems that they did. For late last week, a firmware update rolled out for 2023 models of the ROG Strix SCAR 15 and Zephyrus M16. It's a beta for now, and yes, ASUS says other laptops will be included in further updates coming this month in October. So if you've got an ASUS laptop with inexplicable stutters, you'll probably want to keep an eye out for an update for your particular model. Now we'll just have to see how far back in the timeline ASUS goes. Speaking of going back in time, dial-up internet seems like a relic of the past, but America Online continued to offer dial-up plans well into 2025, but not anymore. As of September 30th, AOL has discontinued dial-up, and the nostalgic screeching sound of bits of data streaming across a phone line has at last been silenced. Per AP, the number of AOL dial-up users was only in the thousands back in 2021, and the AOL service itself has been on a long downward path from basically being the internet for many users in the mid to late 90s to the Yahoo-owned husk of what it once was today. Still, the three-step connection animation, creaky door opening sound, ASL requests in chat rooms, and the curation of extensive friends lists on Instant Messenger are seminal experiences for many who were first introduced to the internet back in the dial-up days. So, rip AOL. I guess I can finally throw away all those hoarded 1,000 free hours CDs.
Goodbye.
But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the weekend. If you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.